Welcome, this is Dr. Plague. Have you ever wondered how an old analog TV signal works and how color was added while maintaining compatibility with black and white TVs? Well, today I'll be talking about the composite TV signal, which carries the information to display an image on a TV. This can be an interesting subject, so please stick around. In this video, I'll be talking about the standard composite TV signal used here in the United States. A little later, we'll show you some real examples of these signals on an oscilloscope. We'll start with the black and white signal. Now, if you're not familiar with how old analog TVs worked, they used an electron gun to send a beam of electrons to illuminate an image on the screen. It draws the image one horizontal line at a time, starting from the upper left corner of the screen. Each horizontal line is drawn from left to right, and the lines are drawn from top to bottom. The electron beam zigzags the screen from the top to the bottom 60 times a second, but it only draws every other line, so it takes two passes from the top to bottom to complete a frame of an image, alternating between odd and even lines. These two passes are called fields. This gives us a frame rate of 30 frames per second. By the way, there are 525 lines per frame, with generally 480 of them being visible. The rest take place when the electron beam is off the edge of the screen or returning to the top of the screen. This means there are 30 times 525, or 15,750 lines per second, so each line takes about 63.5 microseconds to draw. We can use an electrical signal called a composite video signal to control the electron beam. There was a standard developed for this black and white signal put into place by the Electronic Industries Alliance, which is called the RS-170. You have probably heard of RS-232 or maybe RS-485, which are serial communication standards. The RS-170 is just another standard put into place to define a black and white TV signal. Originally, this signal used a 1.4 volt peak-to-peak signal, but now most signals conform to 1 volt peak-to-peak. No matter what the peak-to-peak is, the ratio between the sync pulses and luminance must be maintained, and we'll get into what sync pulses are soon. As the electron beam travels from the left of the screen to the right, the brightness of the line is defined by the voltage level of the signal. The unit of measure for the amplitude of the signal is IRE, where 140 IRE equals 1 volt peak-to-peak. By the way, IRE stands for Institute of Radio Engineers, in case you're curious. Typically, the IRE of a composite video signal ranges from negative 40 up to 100, which is about negative 286 millivolts, up to positive 714 millivolts. Pure black is defined by 7.5 IRE, which is about 54 millivolts, and pure white is 100 IRE, or 714 millivolts. And different shades of gray are in between these two. So, as the electron beam travels from left to right, the voltage can be varied from 54 to 714 millivolts to define the brightness of the line. This is quite simple, but how do we sync up with the electron beam so we know where it is when we are drawing on the screen? This is also simple. We control it ourselves, meaning we tell it when to move back to the left of the screen to start the next line. We also tell it when to move from the bottom back to the top of the screen. We use the negative voltages to control this part of the signal. From there, it is all timing. Now, just an FYI, most TVs are very forgiving and allow you to shift the signal upwards in voltage so that the whole signal ranges from 0 to 1 volt instead of negative 286 to positive 714 millivolts. This will make it easier if you want to create your own video circuit. Also, most TVs are fairly forgiving with respect to small variances in timing, so you don't have to be 100% dead on, but try to get as close as you can. So, to move the beam from the right back to the left side, we send a horizontal sync pulse for 4.64 microseconds, which is negative 40 IRE or negative 286 millivolts. We use this negative voltage to ensure the electron beam is blacker than black, so we don't disturb the image when moving back to the left. From this point, we have what is called the back porch before drawing the next line. The back porch is 0 IRE or 0 volts and is held for 4.79 microseconds. After this, we can send a varying voltage from 7.5 to 100 IRE to draw the line, and we have about 52.66 microseconds of drawing time. When the line is finished being drawn, we enter the front porch for 1.4 microseconds at 0 IRE, which is 0 volts. From here, we repeat for the next line. Now, this seems all well and good, but how do we send the beam from the bottom of the screen back up to the top once we have drawn all the lines? Enter the vertical blanking interval. The vertical blanking interval consists of several lines starting with the equalizing pulses. The equalizing pulses consist of 6 8% duty cycle inverted pulses at twice the frequency of horizontal lines, starting at negative 40 and going to 0 IRE. Then we have the vertical sync pulses, which are inverted equalizing pulses since they are 92% duty cycle. These pulses send the electron beam back to the top. This is followed by 6 more equalizing pulses and then 13 blank lines. You can use less than 13 blank lines, but those 13 are generally not going to be visible. There are 2 fields that are drawn, one for the odd lines and one for the even lines. During the first field, there is half a line drawn at the end of all the visible lines, and during the second field, there is half a blank line before the 13 blank lines in the vertical blanking interval. By the way, there are 240 full lines drawn for each field for a total of 480 visible lines. So, here is a summary of the sections for a single frame. We have 6 equalizing pulses, 6 vertical sync pulses, and 6 more equalizing pulses before the 13 blank lines. Then, we have 240 lines for the picture followed by a half line. This completes the first field. The second field has 6 equalizing pulses, 6 vertical sync pulses, and 6 more equalizing pulses, followed by a half blank line and the 13 blank lines. Then, the second field is completed with the last 240 lines for the picture. We'll show you an example of this shortly, but first, let's talk about color. So, the preceding was all about a black and white signal, but what if we want to add some color to it? We want to make sure that the color signal still works fine on a black and white TV. So, how can we do this? The color signal was defined by RS-170A. Have you ever heard of a color burst TV crystal? This is what we use to add color. The color burst TV crystal operates at about 3.58 megahertz. What we do is add a signal of this frequency to the back porch. About 8 to 11 cycles is good. You generally leave a breezeway of about 0.6 microseconds on the back porch before adding the color burst signal to it. The TV will sync to the phase of this signal. Now, to add color to the picture, all we do is add this 3.58 megahertz signal to the luminance voltage and vary the phase and amplitude of it. The phase can be anything from 0 to 360 degrees. The phase will determine the color, and the amplitude will determine the saturation. That's it! Fantastic! What is phase, you ask? It is simply the shifting of the signal in time. If we take a sine wave and shift it 90 degrees to the right, we get this new wave. Different colors correspond with different phases, such as yellow will be fairly in phase with the color burst. Green will be about 60 degrees out of phase. Blue will be about 180 degrees. And red will be about 280 degrees out of phase. So, how does this work with a black and white TV? The frequency of the color signal, being 3.58 MHz, is too high for the black and white TV to see it. It considers it noise and will just filter it out, and the remaining signal will look like a standard black and white signal. Color TVs are designed to use this frequency to indicate color, so this new color signal will work on both TVs. Likewise, a black and white signal will work just fine on a color TV. The color signal is just missing, so you will see a black and white image. This color system for analog TV was developed by the National Television System Committee, or NTSC. Similarly, there are other systems such as phase alternating line, or PAL, which uses 50 Hz and 625 lines, but we use NTSC here in the United States. So now that we know what the signal should look like, let's take a look at the composite output from an old VCR to see if we can pick out the different sections. Here is the VCR we will be using. First, let's connect the VCR up to a TV and see what it outputs so we know what we are looking at. When I turn on the VCR, you can see we start out with kind of a gray screen with channel 2 shown in the upper right corner. After a short delay, the screen changes to all blue. So, now I'll take the composite signal from the VCR and connect it to a 75 ohm resistor to simulate the 75 ohm input impedance of a TV. I will then connect an oscilloscope probe so we can view the signal. So, let's try to pause on the first vertical blanking interval. We can see the equalizing pulses, vertical sync pulses, equalizing pulses, and about 12 blank lines. Now, let's look at the second vertical blanking interval. We can see the same thing with the half lines added in. The half line after the last of the equalizing pulses gives the beam time to move halfway down between the lines from the first field, so they become interlaced with odd and even lines. Now, let's zoom in to see the color burst signal on the back porch. You can see there are about 9 sinusoidal waves, and we said about 8 to 11 was good. You can also see the color signal over the luminance signal. Now, since the screen is blue, the image sinusoid should be about 180 degrees out of phase with the color burst signal. So, I will overlap the sinusoidal wave over the other waves. And you can see we are in phase with the color burst, but 180 degrees out of phase with the image signal. So, this checks out. Next, let's take a look at the gray screen when we first turn the VCR on with channel 2 in the upper right corner. So, we don't see much for the color signal since this is gray. And you can see where the channel 2 is shown within the first half of the scan lines. Now, let's pop a videotape into the VCR and see how the image signal looks. And you can see a lot of modulation of the scan line. Pretty cool, isn't it? So now you should be familiar with how an analog composite TV signal works, and maybe you can design some circuits to generate one. We'll probably have some future videos in which we do just this. Please leave any comments below. So if you like this video, be sure to peck at that like button, and don't forget to subscribe and peck at that notification bell to be notified of all my new videos as they become available. Thank you, and we'll see you next time, right here on Dr. Plague!